everybody, as you're starting to file into the video room that we have right now. We have a great show ahead for you. I'm really super excited to have this person with us. Actually, I talked to him about it, I think, right after we got done with the very first episode of this, now almost a month ago. I started thinking, like, okay, this can't just be my talking to the group. This has got to be some great people coming in and talking about the great things that they're doing. So I'm really excited about that. While people are coming in still, I wanted to tell you a little bit about some things that are coming up. Next week, we have Joel Denton, who is the band director at Ooltewah High School in Tennessee. He'll be with us next week. And the reason that I'm bringing him on is he taught for 37 years in public school. And now he actually travels the country doing a lot of real intense hands-on leadership training with students all across the country. I love that he was a band director, so he's been in the classroom for a long time. So I'm inviting band directors to come and join us. But it's also going to be a slightly different look at leadership from somebody who's seen it over the long haul. So we're really excited to have Joel with us next week, Wednesday at 4 o'clock Eastern time. So if you're able to join us for that one, please, you know, mark your calendars now and we'll have links and things up. While you're on the internet, actually Koji and I were just talking about, while you're on the internets right now, go to Music for All and their educational resources page that are there. That's there. This is where you can sign up for all of our lecture seminars that we're doing, and you can find some of the older ones that are there too, including the ones about just starting this audition journey. One with Taylor Watts on communication skills. One with myself about leadership and finding your strengths. And then one with our fellow drum majors here from Wando High School about questions and answers. And hopefully you'll find that some of your questions that you're wondering about are going to be there too. I think I've suddenly gotten in the middle of a tornado here in South Carolina. It's really nice. So if the sound gets really wacky, you'll have to tell me and I'll turn it over to one of them for just a second. Anyway, it looks like we've gotten quite a few people to come in, and I'm sure we'll have some people joining us as we go through. But first of all, thank you to the Wando drum majors for being here once again. They're here to answer your questions. So if Koji or myself say something that isn't quite clear, you can go down to the middle of the screen and fill out a question, and they'll be answering those live as you go through. So Audrey and Caroline and Anna are with us today so that they can help us with that. Thanks to Cecily Yoakum, who's set this up and is our technology guru and master of this. She's the one that keeps the lights on for us. So if I say something wrong and suddenly go dark, you'll know that I've upset Cecily, and I don't want to upset the Music for All gods by any stretch of the imagination. Well, let's jump right into it. Today we're going to be talking about Koji, or we're talking with Koji Mori about clarity and fluidity of pattern, and likely some leadership hints along the way. It applies to drum majors new and young, new and experienced, but also to student leaders who have to conduct some kind of sectional throughout your year, whether that's concert band, jazz band, or marching band. The better you understand conducting, the better off you're going to be. So let's dive in. Before we go into the nitty-gritty, I want to explain and sort of introduce you to who Koji is. Most of you don't need that introduction, but there were some things on here that I didn't even know about. So Koji, Mr. Mori, is the director of orchestras at Harrison High School in Kennesaw, Georgia. He holds a master's degree from University of Georgia and bachelor's music degree in music education from Columbus State University. Before he was at Harrison, he was the associate director of orchestras at Lassiter High School. I think people don't realize how much orchestra experience that he has been, that he has now. I know before that he was at a middle school band, but since then he has been teaching orchestra. Mr. Mori was, in 2010, he was selected as a conducting fellow at the University of South Carolina's Conductors Institute, working with professional musicians and conducting an array of orchestral literature for string, chamber, and symphony orchestras. He was invited to Okayama, Japan in 2016 as guest conductor for the city's... Why do I not know that? You and I need to talk about that after we get done here. He also served, by the way, he served as conductor for the Phantom Regiment Drum and Bugle Corps in 2009 and 2008 when they won the World Championship. And if you haven't watched either of those shows, go check them out. We lovingly refer to him as Spartacus whenever he's around, and always ask him to do the cheer when it's there. Anyway, During the summers, Mr. Mori's on staff at Music for All Summer Symposium and the Texas A&M University Commerce. He does a summer music camp series, and he does leadership with a lot of groups and a lot of folks around the country. Lives in Kennesaw with his lovely wife, Brittany, who's one of the most amazing people ever. Their sweet daughter, Kari and Kyler. Koji, thanks, man, for being here. We're really glad to have you. You know, you're one of my heroes from the first time I met you back in 2013. I was like, gosh, this guy's way better at this than I am. So I need to keep him close so he can teach me how to do stuff. To that end, Koji, tell us, you know, one of the things that I think that people would be really interested in before we get into the nuts and bolts of conducting is tell us about your high school experience, especially like take us back to that time when you were maybe just a member of the organization and you started thinking about, do I want to be a leader? Do I want to be a drum major here? What were some of the things that led you to take that leap of faith, kind of where many of our leaders are right now? Why did you choose to jump?
That's a great question, Bobby. You know, there's two different types of people in the world, right? We have our extroverted folk who it's really easy to meet people. And then we have our introverted people who that's like the last thing we ever want to do. That was me in high school. In fact, I was terrified of just joining the marching band because I was the kid in class coming from eighth grade where kids didn't notice when I was absent. I was super quiet, super shy. And I just wanted to be able to, you know, gain some friendships and maybe be able to talk to people. So I thought, well, this marching band sounds kind of cool. Let me give this a try. So really, I only marched for 1 year in high school. And then after that, I kind of thought about going out for leadership. And my senior drum major, her name was Jamie. And she told me, hey, you should really go out for this. You should go out for drum major. And I said, no, there's no way. It's the last place I want to be. I love helping people though. So let me do something else. But she kept pushing me. So she gave me lessons and I ended up going through the audition and I got the position as a sophomore. So I did it for 3 years in high school and learned a lot about just communication. I was obsessed with the whole conducting thing. Once I caught the bug, I mean, I was a kid. Every day, obviously, you have to wash your hands. I mean, even more now. But instead of using a hand towel, right, I would do the natural thing, let it air dry. And that's how I got my reps in or the practicing in. And actually paid off over the course of time because I was able to refine a lot of things. But I was a major nerd in that aspect. So that's kind of did in high school. And then I auditioned for for my college program and got in I'm a trumpet player by trade. And my university didn't have a marching band. So marching band really wasn't a thing for that. But I had a friend that said, hey, we should go audition for Phantom Regiment. And I said, sure, that sounds awesome. Cause I've seen them before. I think they're awesome. I don't think I could ever get in, but you know, what a cool experience it would be to just go through the process and see what they have to offer. So that's what I did. We went up there. I auditioned. I got cut twice, actually, because I auditioned on trumpet and, you know, I passed my music audition. But once they saw me march with my, you know,
1 year,
awesome, one year of marching training, they said, thanks, but better luck next time. I made it past to the final round of the conductor's auditions. They had about 40 people there filling, I think, one spot at the time. And I didn't expect to get that far. So when they asked me simple questions like, hey, tell us about yourself, you know, me being the introvert, that was terrifying. My name is Koji. It was awful, to say the least. So I got cut. And then I auditioned again the following year. And the rest of it is history.
I think one of the things that I'm taking away from that, Koji, that I've heard over and over from many people is, for me, I didn't even think about leadership until someone spoke to me about it as well. And I think that's a big thing for those of you that are going to be seniors or maybe who are already seniors and you're kind of on your way out or have experience with leadership, your one conversation with somebody at the right time can change the course of their life. That sounds Disney after school specialist, but it's not fake. Literally, I can tell you the person and the day when that when they even thought that I had any kind of skill at being a leader, I hadn't thought about it until then. So I think that's a really important thing for all of our experienced leaders to take away from this, that you'll shape the leadership of the band for probably the next 3 years, not just by your job, but how you reach out to people. So I appreciate your sharing that quite a bit.
Hey, Bobby, let me, if you don't mind, yeah. I just want to just add to that, because this is almost irrelevant to drum majors. This is especially being in your program and being a leader of your program, whatever that looks like. The power of a smile, the power of a hello, and especially on the first day when you have new members coming in and you going up to that person that's new, particularly freshmen, and you're saying, hey, it's nice to meet you, or hey, it's nice to meet me. I mean, it's be you and have your personality with it, but people can read being genuine. And that changed everything for me. My first day, I almost walked out of the band room on my first day of marching band camp because I didn't think I could do it emotionally. And there was one kid, his name was Greg, and Greg just happened to run into me. And he said, oh my gosh, you're Asian, you must be cool. And just to give a backstory, there weren't a lot of Asian kids. And I had never heard that in my life as that was something that was cool. I mean, I got made fun of a lot for various things, but being Asian was part of it, because I lived in an area that there wasn't a very high population. So finding somebody like that, and he didn't know anything about me. But from there, he took me and he just said, hey, I want you to meet the trumpet section leader and the drum majors. And just that, it took maybe 10 minutes. And that personal connection, that changed my course forever.
I love it. That's awesome. That's awesome. Okay, when I watch you conduct, whether it's on a podium in front of hundreds of kids, getting them to do an excerpt with you, or whether, you know, I've gotten to, Brittany has shared your orchestra concerts a couple of times, more for when your kids are in the back conducting along with you. But every time I see you, I see this dichotomy of two different things. I see this dynamic, energetic, passionate conductor who seems just completely calm, at ease, and in control of everything that's going on. And when I go back, you know, of course we talk about the Spartacus thing and all that, but if you watch The Red Violin was the next year, when I watched you conducting that, there's just this wide range of emotions and experiences that you bring to the music. So knowing you, I know this is really, that's part of who you are. I've seen you be really dynamic and loud, and then just completely pull it back into this zen-like calm. But how do we as conductors, drum majors, student leaders, how do we quell our nerves and our fears when we're on the podium? I mean, you and I know each other, so you know that before I do the first session at DMI in front of 600 kids, I'm a nervous wreck. But the moment I step out there, it's okay. I know you too. I've seen you be like, oh my gosh, I can't do this, and walk in and just be like, master the room. How do we tell people about that? Like, how do we approach that?
I think there's an element of performance. I think it's a trained and learnable skill, just like anything else. You learn skills, right? When you're learning your instrument, that's the thing I love about music, and particularly with instrumental music. Everybody who picks up the instrument, all of them sound terrible when they start. Nobody is naturally gifted or naturally great at what they do on the instrument. Everybody is actually quite bad, and it sounds atrocious. But you learn that skill over time. And it's not just practicing, but it's what are you practicing? Is it intentional? Are you practicing correctly, right? And I think that's the same thing. For leadership and for how you present or how you perform, I think if you're extroverted, that's awesome. You know, that might become a little bit more natural in that sense, but just because you're able to maybe be the life of the party or just saying hello isn't maybe a hard task for you. But for those of you who, you know, just thinking about the first day of band camp causes you anxiety because you know you're going to have to say something or anything like a hello to somebody you don't know, even if they're younger than you, that's something that you can overcome, but it does take practice, and it's a developed skill. So when I'm on the podium, whether it's you know, for whatever musical ensemble or even that camp. I can certainly relate, Bobby. There's definitely some nerves that go through, and there are lots of things that go through my mind. Oh, I can't do this. But, you know, at the end of the day, I think about what is the purpose behind what am I doing? Is this going to be helpful? And what can I do to be helpful, right? I think there's really, those guiding questions are really important to ask ourselves. And I ask this with every leadership group is, you know, what can you do to help the band or the orchestra or the whatever ensemble that you're in or program that you're in? What can you do to help? And then the second question is very much related to it. And it's is what you're doing now, is it actually helpful? And that's a reflection that you have to really think about for you, is it's knowing the answers. I think everybody, especially when you're going for leadership, you think about, okay, what does the director want? Or what are some things that I can do so that I can really shine for my director? Well, the reality is most of the time, your director's probably been watching you since the first day you joined the program. And it's not so much of what do they want to hear, but they want to see what is your character and what is your intent. So to get back into the performance element, I think about, okay, well, I know this is going to be helpful, and how can I present it in a way that can be either engaging or that can motivate people to either play the passage or to understand the content better. And as conductors, I think in some ways we have to embody the music and what it is. So if I'm, let's say I'm doing the Dies Irae from Verdi, it's very intense, very angry. But if I conduct it, I mean, it's very offensive because it's inappropriate. So I think the appropriateness is really important to think about as well. So you're really, I mean, you're a performer and you have to embody that. If you're not great at it, that's okay. You can learn it because I believe it's a skill that you develop. And the more you do it, the more you put yourself there, you might be freaking out on the inside, but you try to do the best you can. And then you learn from those. You know, for me, going out and speaking in front of 500 people, that causes me some anxiety. Because for me, as an introvert, it's easier for me to just be calm and listen, because that's just natural for me. So I have to think about it even more than normal, I would say. And I talk to Taylor about this a lot, because Taylor's an extrovert, and we talk about, you know, how do you engage students as a teacher in your classroom. And so those are things that I've learned to develop over time, for sure.
I think what's cool about that I hope everybody understands that when you, like, if you go back and watch, it was strange. My oldest daughter is starting to get interested in color guard and some things, and we're talking about bands now. And I was looking at I was trying to find your Spartacus clip, because I sent it out to our kids to have them come, and she heard it and she was like, "What are you watching?" And I said, "Well, come and look." And she saw you, and she's met you before, and she was like, "Gosh, that seems like two different people." And I think that's the point, that you have to play that role. And knowing that, like, when I watch you do that, or when maybe people see me doing this, we're nervous. We really are. We just hide it a lot better. And so if you're saying, like, "Well, I just get too nervous," everybody does. If you didn't, it wouldn't be important. So don't see that getting nervous as a detriment. Honestly, that just tells me that's important to you. So when somebody comes into me to have an audition or an interview and they're nervous, I know that what we're saying has weight and it means something. So that's not a bad thing at all. It really isn't. Okay, so we've talked a bit about this. Now we want to see you, you know, do some stuff and kind of show us some exercises. People are already asking questions about this. So I'm just going to read my question directly. Your conducting has certainly been influenced by your work with Phantom, as they have their own style. I think every drum corps kind of has if you watch their drum majors, they have some different things that they do. And Phantom Regiment kind of sets itself apart as calling it a conductor rather than drum major. Am I correct with that, Koji? It's the conductor rather than drum major.
That's correct.
They have their own style, and certainly you've had several teachers since then that have shaped and formulated your conducting style. What are some of the key principles that you can show and share that have made your conducting more clear and effective?
Sure. So let me preface this. There's a lot of schools of thought with conducting. And honestly, I kind of boil it down to two schools. You have your inside conducting, And from that, actually, that can be, there's a lot of elements, right? We have choral conducting, we have orchestral conducting, we have wind band conducting, and everybody takes a different kind of approach. What we're talking about here, and I just want to make sure I'm clear, is I'm talking about it from more of the drum major, the field conductor perspective. There's a little bit of a different philosophy in how I approach technique, because the technique is different. And a lot of the same principles apply as far as taking a relaxed approach so that you don't injure yourself or injure your joints. But it's really important to make sure that those things are different. If you're interested in that orchestral or wind band side of inside conducting, Elizabeth Green has a great book called The Modern Conductor, and I'm sure Bobby's mentioned it in previous sessions, but that is an excellent book. Some would call it the Bible of conducting.
Yep.
But for me, let's talk about the field conducting aspect. At the end of the day, the technique has to change because you're not dealing with an environment where you have people maybe within 100 feet of you, right? I mean, you're talking about a football field size of people that are constantly changing and moving, and things have to change. So how I approach conducting changes based on what is the need of the ensemble. So there's really three vitals, and these are the most important things that I value in conducting. The first one is time. The second one is clarity. And the third one is musical expression or musicianship. And I'll elaborate on that a little in a little bit. Time is the most important thing. And if I were to rank it, it's time one, clarity is right under it. And then all the way at the bottom is the other stuff. And when I talk about the musician part, that's the gestural part of musicianship, right?
I think every time, percussion instructor in the country just went, yes.
Well, time is the most important thing. At the end of the day, your job on the podium is to make sure that the band has something that they can read and that there's something that's reliable there, right? Being a metronome is part of the job. Yes. And so it's really important that we develop that skill. Nobody comes out of the womb going, all right, I know 120, right? They just don't. So that's, again, another thing, that a skill that you develop. So the question that comes right after that is, well, how do I develop that skill? There's a lot of things you can do, right? Some people listen to the metronome and they just try to memorize it. That's kind of hard to do. So what I like to do, and if I can share, let's see if this works.
Yeah, I like to take, be fine.
I like to take things like pop tunes, because generally pop tunes, not always, but a lot of pop tunes are recorded with click tracks. Yes. So it essentially is a metronome. So let me see if I can pull my screen so you can hear this. But let's say I take a piece of music like... Right, Charles Franz in the house. And so what I'll do is, you can take two fingers, just put it on your collarbone, and just tap along. And of course, the video will probably not sync with the audio, so it'll probably look weird on your end. But then you can turn the volume down so you can't hear it, and turn it back up. Are you still on time? Yeah. How many counts can you do this for? Can you get to 8 counts? 5, 6, 7, 8. Are you still on time? And you can do this for a variety of different pieces. And I call it kind of, it's not word association, but it's song association to memorizing tempos. And that's a great way to at least get you in the ballpark. And once you're getting pretty comfortable with that, then I start with just a basic one pattern. Honestly, I don't even do a four pattern, but I'll just start with something of just one. Can I just keep a consistent beat? Turn the volume down, turn it back up. Am I still on time? That's such an important skill to develop so that you can really understand and pull out, hey, when your director says, I need 144, right? Here's the closer, it starts at 144. Or, you know, here's the ballad, I need a 72. Can you get, you know, at least close to that? If you're at 74 or 70, that's forgivable, right? If you're at 100, not so much. So at least having a point of reference.
I wanted to interrupt you just for a second there, because I think that some of the drum majors who are maybe experienced might be going like, oh yeah, I can do that. No, you can't. Like, I have trouble with that sometimes too. Anna can tell you that there were several times that, and she got really good at it. So that's why I'm bringing it up. Like, we would do something at 160 and then I wanted it at 166. And it was really important that there was that delineation between the two. And so I was like, do you have your metronome? And she had it like right here, you know, in her shirt or on a necklace or on something. Like I wanted that. I would say that I don't care if you've been conducting for 12 years, you started at three. That's a skill that you want to go back to. So sorry to interrupt, but I could feel like the older students going like, oh yeah, I can do that. That's a skill that always requires us to go back and revisit.
It's like playing in tune, Bobby. I think, you know, just because you've played in tune most of the time doesn't mean you're in tune all of the time. And it's a constant skill that's developed, similar to just hitting, you know, the bullseye. There's always more of the center that you can hit. And I, the same thing, I still think about it and I notice, oh gosh, I started that tempo way off. So it's definitely an ongoing skill that's developed throughout. And you mentioned, you know, having a metronome right by the side. As a drum major, that's critical. I'd have my watch on my shoe strapped into my shoestrings, and I'd have the metronome, either an earpiece or one that's hanging right over my neck so that I can always reference that, because that is so, so critical. So that's the most important thing. You've got to have time. And then let's talk about number two, and maybe the major part of this lesson today is clarity. How do you develop clarity? If you have great time, but poor clarity, it's a failure. And let me show you what I mean by that. Let's say my time is pretty good, right? And I can maybe get a relatively consistent pulse, but I don't have a clear pattern, right? You can't read it. And it's not just a matter of I'm bad or I'm not very good. It's not helpful for the band anymore. And so therefore it's unacceptable, right? So it goes back to those questions that I talked about earlier. What can I do to help the band or the orchestra, right, or the, whatever the organization, and is what I'm doing actually helpful? If my clarity is not clear, it's not helpful. So I need to reshape that thought process. So I have five checkpoints that I go through. And feel free if you want to steal these, or actually feel free to take them. They're all yours. All of this is an information buffet. So the first one is fingers, right? I like to keep my fingers together. And when I say that, I mean just the first four fingers, maybe not the fifth finger. I do this with a lot of students when I'm teaching conducting, is I just have them raise their hands. And feel free, if you want to try this with me, you're more than welcome to. But just have them raise their hands and then just drop it. And then look at your thumb. And if you look at where your thumbs are, as they are, this is really the chill state, as I call it, the chill state of the thumb. And that's where I like to keep my thumb. So I keep the first four fingers together, and the thumb is just as it is. So as a whole, my hand shape looks something like this, if you can kind of see it. My first four fingers are together, thumb's not sticking out, I'm not doing any kind of field goal weird things, I'm not together, but it's really just in a relaxed state. And the next thing is hand angle. So my hand angle, a lot of times we don't really think about this until we're looking at ourselves in a video or we're looking at ourselves in a mirror. But as I'm conducting, I really think about what is my hand angle? Is it rotating so that my palms are facing each other or away from each other? But if I'm conducting, what is my hand doing? Because this is one thing, right? But this is a totally different thing. And the clarity, as slight as it may be, here's A, here's B, right? And same thing with fingers. Here's A, if you can see it, mm-hmm, and here's B,
right?
It's a very slight shift, but it makes all the difference in the world. I think those two elements alone can really clean up a conducting pattern, especially for the field conductor, right? The third one is the forearm. And I talk about putting your forearm parallel with the ground, and I kind of have a nice line behind me, and so you can kind of see, but one thing I like to do is you can use a mirror. Usually your bathroom mirror has the largest mirror in your house, and that's a great way to practice, because, you know, if you have a slender mirror, it won't, you know, capture your frame. So I like to use a mirror, and you can either use an Expo marker or maybe something like blue painter's tape. and just make a line so that you can see, okay, when I hit my downbeat, is it parallel with the ground or is it too high? This versus this versus this, right? It's a very different effect. Even if it's high sometimes, you might be able to read the pattern if you're staring at me, but let's be honest, at the end of the day, on marching band, nobody is staring at the drum major, ever.
Mm-hmm. A couple of counts, right?
Right, and even at a standstill, right? And that's usually the only time where they're really looking at you intensely. So your job as a conductor on the field is to say, how can I make this as clear as possible so that when somebody just glances for time, they know exactly where it is without having to overthink it? Because as a conductor, for me, I always wanted to make sure that nobody thought about my technique or nobody would think about, you know, hey, could you make this bigger or could you emphasize this? They already have so many other things to think about. The last thing I want them to focus on is where is the time? So that's why it's so important to make your clarity so clear. So just to review, we have fingers is the first one. Number two is your hand angle. Number three is your forearms. When you hit the downbeat, are your forearms parallel with the ground? And then your elbows are also related to that, right? So I have my parallel arms, but it's also different. I usually like to think about your elbows being about 45 degrees away from your torso here, because this is obviously a little bit, it's not that you can't read the time, but let's be honest, I think it looks a little awkward and a little T-Rex-y, right? So that's really important to get that out. And it makes you look like you have more presence and more confidence as well. Even if you're freaking out on the inside, the perception is that it looks stronger, okay? And then the next one is going to be our shoulders. So shoulders relax in our shoulder joints, right? All of these checkpoints, whether it's the fingers, those are joints. Our hand angle, that's a joint, right? Our forearm and then our elbow, right? Which is a joint in our shoulder joint. Each one is really, really important to think about as you're conducting, especially when you're learning this. I think, Bobby, you talked a little bit about some of the flow exercises.
Right.
And let me show you, if I can just share the screen one more time, a quick video of the flow exercise.
While he's pulling that up, I would tell you, you know, you'll notice that if you've been with me the last few times, there are subtle differences between what we do. Don't lose your minds over that at all. It's more a thing where you're going to find that with each conductor, there are slight differences that are there. But still, if you notice, the ictus is always in the same place. They're just straight lines. The angle's just a little bit different, but still just straight lines that he's going for. And so I don't want anybody to be confused of like, well, wait, you said an arrow, and that's not quite the same thing. It still is all about clarity. And you'll have to decide which of these does the band director like the most at the end of all of this. It's whatever your director likes best, but also like what do you feel? The real truth is that you want to be able to do all things and then hone it back into what's there. To get to that clarity though, this is one of the exercises that Koji uses to get people thinking about the joints and the hinges.
That's right. So can you see my screen with the video of camp?
Yep.
So one thing I want you to notice is just look at, this is really an awareness exercise of what does it feel like when my joints are moving? My fingers, my wrists, my elbow, and my shoulder. Obviously, if you really think about it, the shoulder has the biggest amount of coverage that it has and can affect so much, right? And then it's the elbows that have so much effect. And then the wrist, and then the last one are the fingers. So this exercise is a great exercise.
Your fingers are not
just being aware of where are all of your joints and how are they moving.
Good.
And always thinking about a relaxed state. So if you can look at their shoulders, in particular when they go down.
And out inside.
Okay. And let me stop the sharing, if you can see me again. There's a difference, and I see this a lot as students go ahead and go to their home position, as I call it. I'm ready to conduct, you know? And all of a sudden, everything just goes up, and I almost see a T from their torso to their shoulders. That's a major problem, because automatically that's just your body, it's not only tensing up, but it's gonna create some major issues as you're conducting. And really, whatever you're showing the ensemble, that's what they will at least subliminally give back to you. So if you're showing this, you know, they're probably feeling this, if that makes sense. So so one thing I like to think about is look at the line. If you can even look in front of a mirror and just you raising up your hands and dropping them. And look at the natural line that it has. It's generally gonna be some kind of downward line. You probably will not see a perpendicular T that's made with your torso, but it'll be a downward line. And then see if you can just raise your hands with your elbow joint instead of your shoulders. That's a big difference from raising it with your shoulders first, right? Not only will that save you energy and save you lots of shoulder issues in the future, and I can't tell you how many injured conductors I know just because they had too much tension in their shoulders or other areas of their body, but that will save you so much. And as you conduct, there's a big difference in how you're conveying time and energy to the ensemble when your shoulders are relaxed versus high and tense, right? Mm-hmm. So that's so super important to remember. So fingers is the first one. Can I keep my fingers together and let my thumb chill? The second one is the hand angle. Can I keep my palms? I like to keep my palms flat. I know some people like to raise them a little bit. Either one is fine. And like Bobby said before, even within our scope of field conducting, at the end of the day, sure, it's what your director wants, but always think about for how you're conveying that is what you're giving the most clear pattern for you, right? Everybody has a different body type. And so one thing that sometimes I see people do is, well, I want to conduct just like this person. Well, you might have to modify a little bit because your hands might be a little bit different. So just think about that as you're conducting, what's going to be the clearest? And you can see my palms right now are facing down, particularly when I hit the down beat, the second beat, the third beat. But then when I go to the fourth beat, I'm emphasizing one because generally speaking, one is the most important, right? And so aside from going to beat four, I like to keep my palms down because for me, that's been what I've found to be the most successful for a clear downbeat. But it doesn't mean that's the only way to give a clear downbeat. So just always assess that as you're watching yourself.
I think one of the things that, you know, especially between the two of us, one of the things that I think that I would ask any drum major, conductor, person is why are you doing something? And if they have a pretty clear thought that's body aware and music aware, then I usually am okay with it. There've been a couple of times where I've been like, gosh, I don't understand that. And as soon as they explained it, okay, that I would never have come to that naturally, but that actually makes sense. That's only about 10% of the time. Oftentimes when I've asked drum majors, why are you doing this? I don't know. That's where we're wanting to really kind of flesh some of this out. So I think that's great. You know, Koji, you have a whole set. I loved how you were showing them the exercises that you do. What are some of the things that, you know, it's, well, these are two questions. So the first question is, what are some things to help us get to that relaxed, natural state that's there? You know, I've shown them some flow exercises, but just the bare minimum, just the surface of that. And number two, are there any things that you feel like, man, before I conduct on the field, I've got to do this every day? You know, there are certain stretches that I like to do every time. What are some of those for you? So first question, what are some of the things that we can do to get us into that more natural, relaxed state?
Sure. I think breathing is key. Breathing and either listening to something that's calming, something that's maybe a little bit slower. But those exercises that I showed you, or even just the body awareness exercise, where you just breathe in through your nose, and out through your mouth,
truth.
This has helped a lot for me, just so that I'm not just aware, but even as a daily thing, just to make sure that I know, and I can, and sometimes I have to put imagery in my head about, okay, it's not just hands. Maybe my hands are paintbrushes, right? And the brush, how smooth can I make my hand just as a brush would, right? I had a great conducting teacher that told me once, you know, imagine that you're in a body of not water as a pool, but molasses. And what would that feel like? And you can try this. If we're able to go back to a pool anytime, maybe this summer, maybe. If you're in the pool and you move, right, you don't move like this. There's always resistance. And anybody who's been in a pool ever, if you're tall enough to reach the bottom, you know the joy of getting right on the surface of the pool and going, whee! Right? Now, the cool thing is the next time you do that, the thing, if you go underneath, you're starting really fast, but as soon as the water hits, there's a resistance that happens. And the same thing is true for when I think about conducting. That resistance is really important to show. And so if you think about yourself in some kind of body of water or molasses is really gooey, what does that feel like? And what would that look like? Well, if I even look at a paintbrush and I'm painting, right, there's not necessarily there is a little bit of resistance. The resistance would be between the end of the handle to where the brush is. And for us, that would be the end of our wrists here to our fingers, the fingers acting as a brush. And so there's some exercises you can do. You can do a counting exercise where you go up for four counts. 1, 2, 3, 4. Down, 2, 3, 4. Right? A lot of times when you're first starting this, you may have a not so steady hand, right? And that's okay, but it's something to be aware of. Why am I so tense here? You might have to shake it out a little bit and then modify the exercise. 1, 2, 3, 4. Down, 2, 3, 4. Can you go down, 2, 3, 4, and up, 2, 3, 4. And it's really, again, getting that sense of awareness of how are my joints moving and how can I get them to move so that they cooperate together, if that makes sense. But that those kinds of imagery ideas, the paintbrush thing, the relaxation through just understanding my body and what does that look like, that's been a really huge thing for me. And then at the end of the day, it's not just practicing. I always practiced in front of a mirror, especially in high school. And I was, I won't say borderline obsessive. I was obsessive over how can I get my time better or clearer. And it was something that I just pursued. But those were the things I looked at. I looked at those checkpoints and I went, okay, I didn't know they were checkpoints at the time, but what can I do to make it clear? Okay, my fingers are together. I have my stance. All right, what's the next thing? And I would watch conductors like a hawk, whoever came in, whether it was my band director or a guest band director or an honor band clinician, whoever it was that I could get my eyes on, I would just really analyze why is their pattern look the way that it does. And especially if I saw something that was particularly good, I would say, okay, how can I mimic that? And I did a lot of this in college as well, thinking through how do I do that? And so I would go back to my dorm room after class and I would conduct in front of a mirror and think about, okay, well, no, that joint was a little bit different. Oh, you know what? He talked a lot about flow. Let me see if I can incorporate flow. And it may have looked pretty silly in the beginning. And there is like, this is too much flow. My wrist is too limp. But this is too rigid. So how can I find something right in the middle? Right. And as you gain an awareness of your body and your joints and how they move, either cohesively or not cohesively, you'll understand, you'll find a point where you can find where they can live together harmoniously.
Is there, the second part of that question was, are there any exercises that you feel like I kind of need to do this to just get myself centered or in the right place? Like before I remember you and I had a conversation one time that when you were at Phantom and you had to do like waking everybody up and different things the morning before rehearsal, you would have headphones in listening to the music that you were getting ready to conduct a little bit later on that day. Or I think you were even telling me, like, on the bus on the way to shows, you would just put that in and just kind of, you know, remove yourself from the world for just a little bit. You know, are there some of those conducting things that you feel like, you know, this for, well, what was your ritual, for lack of a better word, for getting ready for rehearsal or performance?
That's a great question. I think, you know, let me answer that with another question, is what creates confidence? You know, how do we create confident performers? People are confident not just because they're, I'm confident, right? Maybe if you're the 1%, but you get that way because you've trained and you've developed your skill enough to be able to do that. So whether it was a show or whether it was a concert I was conducting, or maybe it was my conducting final, regardless of what it was, I was really, really invested in it, mainly because I was just a major nerd about conducting. But aside from that, I wanted to make sure that I was really prepared for that piece that I was going to be going into a performance with. So if I had any hint of a slight, if I didn't know what measure letter A was and what note the baritones had, I would always be refining, going, okay, what do they have there? Can I memorize that better? And whether it was listening to it, or a lot of times when I was at regiments, I would just be with the percussion rehearsals, and I'd be with the battery and the front ensemble, because those are the parts that glue everything together. Melodies are easy to remember. Harmonies are even pretty relatively easy to remember. The counter lines, the bass lines, and certainly the inner workings of how the percussion works with the ensemble, that's not super easy to memorize, especially because there's a lot of variations in it. It's not just a four-bar phrase that's repeated over and over and over again. And I'm not saying that melodic instruments have that throughout the pieces, right? But what one thing I would do is just, first of all, I'd get in a state of mind where I could be awake. So if it was the morning before everybody was waking up, I'd wake up before the core. And then I would get, you know, either grab my cup of coffee or read something that was important, devotional, whatever it was, and then get my headspace in a place where I could really tackle what I had coming for that day. I'd have my notes out. I'd have my scores out. I'd be listening or studying through and really looking at and borderline obsessing over the parts and how they connected with each other. And then once you understand that, it's one thing to understand it here, but then how do I get on a podium and convey that confidence? Well, I think it's very similar to acting, in my opinion. Whether it was the Spartacus show or you know, conducting in front of thousands, whatever it was, I had to think about, okay, it's not me, Koji, doing this right now because I'm shy and I'm introverted. That's not me. I don't do that. But I knew that was necessary, and I right. knew that's what that needed to happen because that's what the core needed, or that's what the ensemble needed. How can I help them best? Well, they need me to do this. Okay, then I can accomplish that. So let me put myself in a headspace where maybe I think of a character that's similar to that, right? Maybe it's a character from a movie, or a character from a book, or a character from a cartoon. You know, it's it can be anything, whatever you can associate, you know, anger or joy or happiness. It might be a memory that you personally have. And then, you know, dig deep into that and just engulf yourself in that moment. You know, when I was on the field, at finals, or really at every performance, that Spartacus ending that everybody knows only happened for like three shows, maybe right. four. It was the last 10 days of tour. And so for every one of those, you know, there's a part that the camera happened to take, and I get this comment all often is, you know, wow, did they tell you to look at him so angry or angrily? And I said, no, I really wanted to kill him. You know, and that was really the mentality that I had. Of course, from like an acting, you know, I bought in all the way. And then after the show, it's a lot of energy to be a performer in that aspect. So if you're trying to embody the music, engulf yourself in what the character of the piece is. And that leads to really that musician, the third part, right, that we talked about, musical expression. How do I show musical gestures? Well, it starts with developing your musicianship, right? So be the best instrumentalist that you can be on your instrument, right? You should be like busting your tail, so that you can develop your individual skill and musicianship so that you can be a better musician? Can you understand phrasing? When you understand things like, okay, how is music phrased? Why is music the way that it is? What creates an angry feeling or a sad emotion or what makes something happy? Then you can start to really, like, you don't have to think about, oh, happy looks like this, right? It's not so mechanical. It becomes, oh, I can connect it. I understand what it is, but I can also associate what that feels like because I have life experience for that. Or if I don't have life experience for that, I can relate it to something that really touched me deeply from either whether it's a movie I saw or a documentary I saw, whatever you can kind of emotionally connect it to so that you can embody that. And then I found that for me, I was able to perform that aspect or act that aspect much more easily because I felt like I was that character.
Right. So maybe one of the last things that we'll do, and maybe we'll have a little bit of time for a couple of questions. So if the drum majors have anything that they want to bring to Koji's attention here in just a minute, I know you and I talked about, you know, let's really put this into practice for just a second. Let's say that I'm doing a release and there are multiple types of releases. We haven't gone through cueing yet. That'll be coming up in a future episode, but you have a real process that you go through in thinking about the release process. Could you, because, and it does involve the flow study with, if the music calls for that, can you kind of walk us through your process of doing any kind of release in general? And then if you want to get more specific, you can.
Sure. I usually think about, and this, it kind of relates to cues as well. I think about a 3-step process for releases or cues. So let's say we want to release on 1, right? So there's always a preparation and there's always some kind of circular motion. And then of course the execution of the release. So if the execution is on 1, then I think about, okay, then I got to have some kind of circular motion. In conducting, anything that you show circular generally means stop. So I have to be careful with whether any kind of gestures that I give that I don't inadvertently do something like that, because that tells the ensemble, whether I want them to or not, it tells them to stop. So let's say, let's get some room here. Let's say I want to give a 4 pattern and do a release on 1. 1, 2, 3. Now normally with 3, I would keep going. But in this particular instance, 1, 2, I'll hit 3, I'll call it a chop, chop, and then circle off. The chop is acting as a preparation, right? 1, 2, prep, and then I'm going into my preparation of creating the circle and then executing the release. 1, 2, prep, circle, off. And it applies for any beat that you do. Let's say I want to release on 3. Well, the circular motion would have to be on 2, and the preparation would start on 1. 1, 2, 3, 4, prep, circle, off. I'll do that again. Feel free to follow along. 1, 2, 3, 4, here's 1, prep, beat 2 is the circle, circle, off, okay? And one thing I do want to talk about with the release, I know a lot of times we see this often, right? Prep, circle, off, and down. There's nothing wrong with that. My only question is it as clear as if you were to end on the same place? So for example, 1, 2, 3, 4, prep, circle, off. Right? Everybody knows that the downbeat is here. How do they know that? Because you've been conducting a pattern where your ictus is there the entire time. If I make a release where I grab it, the only thing that you have to really be careful is you have to know exactly where that release point is. If you don't know where it is, there's no way your band will know where it is. Because the release could either be, is it here? Is it here? Is it here? Or is it here? Release. Well, where was the release point? If you're going to do that, make sure it's release and you actually have something that there's, at least you can imagine a physical stopping point where the release point happens. Otherwise, it becomes ambiguous and there's really no sense of, hey, we're all ending here. If you end on your conducting plane, 1, circle, off, then that's very clear because you've already been hitting that same point the entire time. So that's my recommendation. You certainly don't have to do that, especially I know there's lots of band programs with traditions on how they release, but just remember when you're doing a release, is it make sure that you have a clear point of where that hand stops, because at the end of the day, your patterns have to be helpful for the band. Right. It goes back to everything. Is what I'm doing how helpful, right?
And is it the most efficient and effective way?
Right. Yeah,
absolutely. That, honestly, if you overlay those two filters on pretty much any decision that you have to make as a leader, you're going to be in good shape. Not how do I feel about this person? How do I feel today? Am I being helpful? Is it the clearest, most efficient way to make it go? I think that's huge.
Hey Bobby.
Yeah, go for it.
I want to share one more thing with everybody. Because you talked about patterns, and if you can kind of see this pattern, we talked about the arrow pattern, right? Patterns can change a lot, and that's okay. These are the fundamental basics. We're talking about time and clarity, right? And we talked about the checkpoints. But start with the arrow pattern. That's the best one to start with because it's clear and it's easy to remember. And so what I like to do is I'd really like to visualize what is that pattern. And when I'm conducting, I think about the tallest point, which isn't a baton. If I had a baton, it'd be the baton. But in our case, it's the middle finger. And if I had a Sharpie or an Expo marker on the tip of that, can I trace that pattern just like it looks like on the arrow, right? Now, whether I'm doing an arrow pattern or maybe a modified classical pattern where each beat is on a different point, or maybe something that looks, you know, a hybrid of the two. One, two, out for three, back in. It doesn't really matter what it is. At the end of the day, it has to line up with, is it musically appropriate? And is it clear? Okay, so those are just some things I think about. Can I trace that pattern? And through the rehearsals, I would always think about, okay, I want to use a modified classical pattern here. All right, well, can I trace that? I'm imagining my points. Are my points hitting at different points of my line as I'm conducting? So it's just another visual element that you can think about as you're doing your patterns.
My drum major friends, do you have any questions that you felt like you had to answer a few times that maybe you'd like to pass on to Mr. Mori?
Not the answered ones, but we do have two that were left unanswered that we thought would be good. One is, in a world-class drum corps, what is your role as a core drum major and how much different is it from high school marching band?
That's a great question. Drum corps is very different from high school marching band with the mentality and expectations that not just the staff has, but the other members have as well. So in that respect, it's very different. Now, each corps has its own culture and each corps approaches things very differently. Some have a very clear expectation of what they want their drum majors to do or their conductors to do. Some just say, hey, figure it out. So it depends on the corps that you're in. It depends on which group that you're a part of. It's certainly worth asking what are the roles, but leaning towards other members of the group who have been there before you're in the group can certainly lead to a lot of answers to questions that you might have. So it depends is the short answer for all of that.
And then we had one more. What are some good exercises or tips on improving left hand and right hand independence?
Oh, that's a great question. You know, and I can nerd out on this all day, but let me give you a great one. I like to start with the one pattern. So keeping something consistent in your right hand with the one pattern at all times. You can have the metronome going. That's probably the best thing to do. And with your left hand, do something that you can do normally, right? So let's say, I don't know, I want to watch TV. Well, pick up your remote, right? As you're keeping your right hand steady, pick up the remote and see if you can turn on the TV. Can you turn the channels, right? Can you move it to a different location, right? Can you open a book, right, and open the pages? Can you turn the page, right? And if you get pretty comfortable with that, then do a two pattern. Same thing. Okay, I'm going to pick up the pencil and just move it, right? Go to a four pattern when you get really comfortable with that. Can you open the refrigerator? right? Can I get the butter out? Can I close the refrigerator? Can I get the bread out, right? Can I get the knife out? Be careful with this. Can I spread butter on my toast, right? And not at the same time as my motions, but of course, independently. So I always like to start with the one hand and use just a regular everyday task. You can take a selfie, right? Anything that requires something totally different from what your right hand is doing, that is a great way to develop this independent relationship, because this is not natural. And then that's okay. It's a developed thing. The other thing I like to do is I like to do, you know, contrary motion with the two hands and just maybe doing 4 beats at a time or 8 beats at a time. And really the point is, when you're reaching the change of direction, how smooth can you get that change of direction? If you can see closely, is it here or is it here? Right? The smoothness, and it goes back to kind of that imagery of the paintbrush. Can you get that same flow, or that are you aware enough of your joints to where you can make that, manipulate your hands to create that illusion, so to speak?
I love it. Those are all great things. And so, Koji, I'll let you have kind of the last word, and I'm going to ask you this. If you have any piece of advice, or you know, parting words for the folks that are getting ready to go through this leadership season, and for some it's for their first time, for some it's multiple times. But just want to remind everybody that next week, like I said, Joel Denton will be with us. That's going to be an episode that you're not going to want to miss, because he's going to get really in depth with how to engage all kinds of issues. He's been doing this a long time, and he's kind of dealt with all kinds of stuff. His bands, and what's very cool, it was a smaller school at one point especially. And so for those of you that come from smaller programs, he's got a little bit of a different take on student leadership than maybe what some of us from larger programs would have. So you want to check that out. The other thing I would tell you is I'm really excited about this. I'm recording a session this week with Stephanie Grody, who Koji knows very, very well, dear friend of ours. Stephanie is actually the first female conductor of Santa Clara Vanguard in its 50-year existence. And she hasn't been the last. There have been several to follow her. But she has a couple of things. She's actually studying to be a school psychologist, school counselor. And so she's actually taken what we know in the band world of leadership and now overlaid more psychological and physiological studies on top of that, and has a slightly different thing that she's bringing to that. It's called motivational interviewing. It's really a cool concept that I can't wait to find out more about. And then the other thing that we have is she's doing a session on salutes. That's right. And for those who maybe have come to our camps before, she has done a massive job with that, really researching what it is. She actually handed it over to Taylor, who's done it for us the last couple of years. But I know for some of you, the salute is actually part of your audition. And if you're like me, I knew nothing about it. The truth is, it shouldn't be a make or break kind of thing for you, but it should be something that you know, number one, why we do it, and the right ways and the wrong ways to do it. There are some really wrong ways that you can do it that will actually be offensive to any of the military personnel that are in the audience. So we want to make sure that you're aware of those things. That'll be a recorded episode that we'll just upload a little bit later down the road. So Koji, if you would maybe give us the final word, you know, what are the patterns for success that you feel like, you know, students need to follow? Or what's your last piece of advice for us?
Thanks for having me, Bobby. By the way, this has been a wonderful thing. And Bobby does such a great job with teaching all of us. And I'm really glad that you're able to offer this for students who are interested in this. You know, my last piece of advice would be genuine. That's probably the most important thing. You know, Bobby talks about character, content, communication, right? Those are all great. Chemistry is huge. But all of that really comes down to beginning of you and how is your character? Are you being genuine with what you say and what you do, right? Respect is a byproduct that'll come from that. And I know a lot of people ask me, like, hey, how do I get respect from my peers? Well, are you genuine with what you're doing and what you're saying? And that usually answers a lot of the questions on how do I fix X, Y, Z? Well, are you genuine, right? Is what you're doing helpful for the band or for the people around you? So as you're approaching these leadership interviews or applications, make sure that you're you, There's only one of you. You don't have to copy somebody else. You can aspire to be, you know, like your senior drum major. I certainly did. I wanted to be like Jamie, but I knew that I wasn't Jamie. I had to be me. And so how you carry yourself, make sure that you're true to yourself, and make sure that you're genuine with what you do and what you say.
Yeah. Well, as always, I learned something from Koji, way more than I'm wondering if the students are getting as much as I'm getting out of what you have to say. It's you're one of my heroes, and I really appreciate your being here with us. And thanks once again to our Wando drum majors for giving up yet another time, hour of their lives to come and help us out. I got to look at some of the questions going on. Number one, thanks for some great questions that you're giving us to think about. And thank you to these fine people for giving great answers. I was typing something and somebody beat me to it and said it way better than I did. So I'm so thankful for that. And Cecily, thank you for doing this. Again, next week, Wednesday, 4:00. Hopefully we'll catch you here. Bring a friend next time and we'll talk some more patterns for success. See you guys later. Have a great week.